I've combined my announcements into my message this week, so I'm not redundant. But welcome to all of you. So great to have you here. May gratitude for God's abundant gifts be with you all. Thanks for being here. And we have a slight change to the bulletin. We're doing Sing the Faith number 2152 for the second song, which is after my opening prayer. So we've got it on the slides, and you guys know that song. So just wanting you to know that. And if you are a first or second time visitor, there's a connection card. We would love your information, and we'd love to bring you a gift, if you don't mind sharing that with us. And you can put that connection card into the offering plate during the offering. Those of you who are online as well, we would appreciate you letting us know of your presence today by doing that. So let's give praise to God. Today's Stewardship Sunday. It's all about giving thanks to God. So let's stand and praise the Lord.
Is he faithful? Does he see me in my trouble? Does he understand? Sometimes I question if he's able. Can he rescue? Can he save me again and again? When I look back, tell me I'm forgotten and I'm falling too far from his hands. But I know what kind of God he is, and I'm trusting him. His promises I'm believing, and I'm singing, yes he can. I've seen too much and I can't deny he's come through every single time, from the beginning until the end. He did, he will, he can. Did he move every mountain? Did he part every sea? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Oh, did he defeat the darkness? Did he deliver me? Yes, he did. So yes, he can. Did he move every mountain? Did he part every sea? Yes, he did. So yes, he can.
Lord, you defeated everything that seeks to weigh us down and make us feel bad about ourselves, bad about the world, Lord. You entered into our flesh, Lord, at Christmas, born in a stable, a lowly stable, Lord, to a troubled couple. And you, Father, showed us in Jesus, your Son, how full of love you are, and that you would never, ever let us go. You're in the depths of our flesh, Lord, and you're driving out everything that is broken from within and around us. Your Spirit is alive and well, and we thank you, Lord, that love and goodness and peace and truth win the day. We take time now, Lord, to ask you to come to us and change our hearts, for you are the potter and we are the clay, Lord. We want to become more and more like Jesus. And so hear now the ways, Lord, that we've fallen short, and help us to become the people that you're calling us to be. Hear the good news. Who's in a position to condemn us? Only Christ Jesus. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. And Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone and a new life has begun. So know that you are forgiven and be at peace and share that mercy and peace with each other and the world. And also with you. Peace be with you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Peace be with you.
I'm super psyched.
I love that.
I'm psyched. Thank you for that.
I've never been able to take it in public until now.
Awesome.
And I'm like, oh, this is kind of exciting.
So really exciting. And basically anytime. I love
I
the solos.
Something. Yeah.
All right? Maybe like once or twice a month. Peace be with you. Nemat, turn this one up, please. Nemat. 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 Turn this mic up for me.
Yep.
In the sanctuary, yes. And boys and girls, you can come forward. Maddie, Chloe, Connor, come on up. You guys will continue fellowship after our service today at our potluck. We're having a Thanksgiving feast after worship today. I'm going to teach you a couple new words today. One is dominion, which is one of my favorite board games. Dominion. Dominion means having the charge over something. Do you know what having the charge of something means, or taking charge of something? What does taking charge mean?
Ruling over.
That's right. That's right. Hey, Todd's joining us up front. That's awesome. And here comes Sage too. Awesome. So in the beginning, when God created, when God created everything, guess who he made last? He made Jesus in the fullness of time, and you basically got the right answer because he made human beings last. We were at the top of God's creation, and God said, making you human beings in my image. That means that everything that is good about God is deep inside all of us, all right? The Spirit of God, the love of God, the peace of God, the truth of God, all those things are the deepest parts of us. And we are called, then, to reflect, since we're made in God's image. Where do you see your image when you look in the morning?
Where do you see your image?
In the mirror, that's right. And so we're supposed to be like a mirror that reflects God out into the world, okay? That's our job. That's what human beings are supposed to do. And God gave us charge or dominion over the whole world, all the animals, all the plants. I think it's so cool that the ancient Israelites, when they wrote this book like 3,000 years ago, something like that, they knew that human beings were super powerful. But there's also a problem with human beings, right? We don't do a very good job of reflecting God out into the world. Because our job is to take care of the plants and the animals and other people, and to make sure that basically everybody experiences as much of the kingdom of heaven as is possible. Our job, because we're stewards, this is the other word I wanted to teach you. A steward is somebody who's given charge of something, but they don't own it. So we don't own the world, right? Who owns the world? God owns the world. That's correct. And so we've been given this world to take care of it and make sure that the world becomes as God wants it to become. And the way that God wants this world to become is like heaven. Okay? So basically, we have to do, what does heaven look like? When you think of heaven, what do you think of? A bunch of happy people. Amen. Yeah, what's heaven like? What? All is peace? All is peace. Amen. Everybody's happy, and all is peace, and all is love. Okay, we're surrounded by love. Is anybody hungry in heaven? Nobody's hungry in heaven, right? Is anybody hurt in heaven? So what we have to do is we have to make this world as much like heaven as possible, trying our best to never hurt people, trying our best to bring peace to this world, trying our best to make people happy. And the way that people become happy is by way of love. And now Sage has a word of wisdom for us because she's a sage. Of course she has a word.
God loves us.
Loves us. She gives us the most important word every time we come forward for the children's message. Do you have something else to add to it this time?
about that right now, right? Are you guys ready to sing about that? All right, cool. Well, let's have a prayer first. We'll pray and then we'll sing. Everybody, repeat after me. God of love, thank you for this beautiful world. Thank you for setting us in your paradise. Help us, O Lord, to bring peace and joy to this wonderful world. Amen. Thank you. Great job. Now we're going to sing. All right, those of you who want it, those of you who know it, which is Chloe, Connor, and Sage. And the congregation is going to join verse 2 when we sing Jesus Loves Me. So I'm tying the announcements into my message this week. I restarted my sermon on Friday. I wrote half my sermon, and then I'm like, I ain't going that way. It's too heavy. It's Thanksgiving Sunday. I got to talk about everything that's good in my life, everything that's good in our world. Everything's a gift, right? Everything is a gift from God. And when we remember that, our lives are filled with gratitude for what is good in our lives and what is good in our world. And so I had to shift it up. I'm going to get heavy for a little while because I can't avoid it entirely. That's just my character. That's my nature. And there's things that need talking about in our world today. But I want to start by giving thanks for Jesus. Some 25 years ago, this is the 25th anniversary of the time that my life was completely changed. I went from a self-centered, kind of despairing young adult to somebody who suddenly had a purpose. Somebody who was at war kind of with himself, feeling guilty, bad, shamed, to somebody who was just so excited for life. And that happened because I decided to do this fantastic thing called prayer. I was in a desperate situation, and I thought, why not It can't hurt. And I prayed, and when I prayed, the Spirit of the Lord, I thought, well, I don't know in what faith tradition I should pray, because I don't believe in any of them. But since I was raised a Christian, why not do the Christian prayer? And I asked Jesus to come into my heart, because that's what I learned when I was a little kid. I said, Jesus, come into my heart. And when I cracked the door open just a little, even though I didn't believe it, when I just cracked that door open, and I wish this would happen for each and every one of you who haven't come to know the Lord, but when I did it that day, I felt a peace and a presence, and I heard a word from the Lord. All of that was like the realest of real experiences I've ever had in my life. So in the 25th anniversary, I give thanks for the Spirit of Jesus coming into my heart and completely changing my life. I give thanks for the Word of God. I told you we're tying announcements into the message this week. And I give thanks for the great story of God. We're doing a year of the Bible. And if I have anything to do with it, we're going to have a year of the Bible every single year. Because we all need to get to know the great story of God. It's the great story of God that fills our lives with meaning and with purpose and with understanding. And so every year, I think moving forward, I hope this congregation does a year of the Bible and commits to reading the Bible regularly. I give thanks this week for fellow disciples who journey with me through the Bible. We're watching these amazing videos every week called the Bible Project videos. And these folks gather with me on Tuesdays and Thursdays, and hopefully moving forward on Fridays as well. And we learn together, and we pray together, and we fellowship together, and we learn about that great story of God. We do that every week, but it ain't happening this week because I'm going to be on vacation. So who gives thanks for vacations and holidays? Can I get an amen? Amen. I'm super excited about not doing much of anything. My son is back from college, and we're going to hang out and maybe play some golf if the weather stays decent. And just enjoy wonderful shows and wonderful movies together. I give thanks for how God works through technology and works through entertainment in this incredible world that we live in. Vacation reminds me to give thanks for a couple of leaders of this church, Pastor Ken McCary and Elder Linda McCary. Pastor Appreciation Month was a month ago back in October, and I forgot to give thanks to him. So let's give a hand to Ken and to Linda. Let's keep giving a hand to Lu Young and Alexa, our musicians. They're incredible week in and week out. Todd, do you want to give thanks to somebody? Come on out here, guys. Come on out here. Yes, 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 yes. Amen. Thank you. We don't need you, but thank you. Thank you. Just saying thanks to you. Yes, Todd. Yeah? Thank you very much, Todd. Thank you very much. Thank you. And for those of you online, Todd just graciously said that every week should be a Pastor Appreciation Week, and thank you for that. Thank you. Actually, yeah, I think all of us don't necessarily feel appreciated enough. In our workplaces, in our homes, we need to do a better job of honoring one another and giving thanks for one another and appreciating one another. So parents, appreciate your children more. Children, appreciate your parents more. Spouses, give thanks regularly for your spouse, despite the occasional brokenness in our homes. Next week, Ken is going to be preaching. Next week's going to be our first week of Advent. And we're starting Advent early because Advent week four is on Christmas Eve this year, and the session decided not to do a morning service as well as our evening services. And so we're starting Advent a week early, and I can't wait. I mean, December is like my favorite month of the year. Anybody else? I love December, despite the cold. Maybe it's because I'm from Minnesota. I can just deal with the cold. I was kind of a wimp when I was there and thought I would never go back. But I just, right, all the lights, all the greenery, all of the happy holidays, Merry Christmas, the spirit of joy that is in the air and excitement throughout Christmas. I give thanks. If you haven't attended our Advent services and our Christmas services, you're in for a treat. They're just great. Those of you who have been coming here for years know what I'm talking about. I give thanks for the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, calling us out of the darkness of self-centered living and into community service. Yesterday, our food bank gave out 160 bags of groceries to hungry people, making sure that a hungry family could be fed for 4 or 5 days, something like that. And so I give thanks for everybody involved in that. I give thanks for the thrift shop as well. We've got a thrift shop over here underneath the dining room when you go over for our Thanksgiving feast. They gather every Wednesday from 10 until 3, and they clothe people with Christ. They share fellowship. They show kindness and love and welcome and hospitality to everybody who enters. And the same goes for the food bank folks every third Sunday of the month. And all the proceeds for the thrift shop go to local charities, by the way. I'm going to pause now with my gratitude and talk about why it's important to give thanks. We live in a very heavy world. And that heavy world can weigh us down. And we can allow our minds and our hearts to sink. But what Thanksgiving does is it takes our minds off of what is wrong with the world and it puts them on what is right. It takes our minds off of what is bad with our world and it puts our minds on what is good. Now, that's what the Apostle Paul tells us to do. He tells us to rejoice in all circumstances. And the Apostle Paul was in prison when he said that. He had learned to rejoice in all circumstances. Even though he was unjustly in prison, he said, I can still rejoice. I can still share the gospel with the guards who were starting to believe in the incredible gift of eternal life and the love of God. Paul said, you all, and he was writing to the Philippians, you all need to keep your minds on what is excellent and worthy and honorable and good and pleasing. And that's what gratitude helps us do. When we remember how much goodness is in our lives, how much goodness is in the world, our spirits are lifted up. The psalmist said, why are you so downtrodden, O my soul? As he remembered God and God's love. And that's what we ought to do, giving thanks for the abundant blessings that fill our lives day in and day out. I got to thinking about one of the reasons why Jews and Christians have been so resilient and generally speaking, succeeded wherever we are in the world. And I think it's because we don't have any choice about gratitude and thanksgiving and joy and praise. No matter what the world is hurling at us, we are told to give praise to God and to give thanks for what indeed is good in our lives. We have an entire book that's dedicated to this. The entire book of Psalms is all about giving praise and thanksgiving to God. And guess what Jews did week in and week out whenever they were being oppressed by various peoples around the world? They would gather on the Sabbath and they would read and they would sing the Psalms and they would be lifted up from whatever was falling against them. And they would be able to endure. Why are we resilient? Why are we successful? Because we know that God is in charge. And we know that God is going to win the day in the long run. And we Christians are particularly assured of that because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Sometimes it seems that the fallen world just wins over and over and over again. But guess what? It's not the case because Jesus came and he went. It looked like he was defeated up on the cross. And what happened 3 days later? He He was resurrected from the grave, and he appeared to the disciples multiple times. He appeared one time to over 500 people, said the Apostle Paul. And Paul said, if you doubt the resurrection, go talk to some of those people. Most of them are still alive, said Paul. And so we Christians know the victory of God. And I think others who believe in eternal life and believe in heaven understand the victory of God the Creator as well. I experienced this week this resilience, this hope from a couple of Jewish female leaders. One is a rabbi in Jerusalem, and she talked about her peacemaking efforts with Muslims and Christians in Jerusalem. But she talked about how ever since October 7th, she felt abandoned. She and her people, her Israeli people, have felt abandoned by the international community and abandoned by the interfaith community as well. She talked about how the silence from the interfaith community around her was deadly. It was just breaking down her soul. And then another American Jew, a visiting professor at New York University here, just up in the city, she took it a step further. She talked about how her colleagues and her students, most of them were silent, others were vocal in victim blaming, basically putting responsibility for October 7th on Israel. And I'm so grateful for these two strong and incredibly eloquent women talking about essentially how little we know and realize about what it's like to be hated and to be persecuted. They've been persecuted for century after century, and here it is happening again. And of course, yes, our fellow Palestinians in Gaza are being persecuted, and their life is being overturned as well. But friends, we need to take seriously the anti-Semitism and the Islamophobia and the xenophobia that are undercurrents in our own nation. But guess what else is even more prominent in our nation? In our nation, we are a melting pot or a salad bowl from the very beginning. We have been a nation with, I believe still, a special calling from God to welcome all peoples and to learn how to live together and be a witness to the rest of the world. To say, this melting pot, this salad bowl is exactly how the world is supposed to be. And so I give thanks for tomorrow night's interfaith service at Immaculate Heart of Mary, just down the road. It's time for us friends, and especially us Christians, to call people to what may be the most poignant of Jesus's teachings, and that is to strive to love our enemies and to pray for those who persecute us. And this is what we're going to do tomorrow night. I did it a couple of Thursdays ago up in Elizabeth for an interfaith service, and we're doing it again at IHM. We need to gather together. We need to remember Psalm 23, that the Lord prepares a table before us in the presence of our enemies. For what purpose? To break bread, to talk, to recognize that we're all made in the image of God, and to learn how to live in peace with one another. I am most grateful for all of you, those of you who are active on boards, committees, mission teams, those of you who are regular in worship. You are the heart of our church. You are the bones of our church. Without you, none of this would happen. And because of you, we are out there leading these communities, Fanwood, Scotch Plains, Plainfield, and beyond, leading these people into the very kingdom of God. And so I thank you. I thank you, Christian Education Committee. I thank you, Mission Committee. I thank you, Hospitality, Personnel, Deacons, Elders. We have about 60 leaders serving on committees, boards, and I You support me as well. I wouldn't have a job without you. Because without your gifts, and it is Stewardship Sunday, without your financial gifts, I wouldn't have a job. Without your financial gifts, Lou Young and Alexa wouldn't be singing before you beautifully every single week. And so we need your continued support. We have a Thanksgiving potluck. The fellowship committee I neglected, they do wonderful work every single week. Come and join us over in the dining room after worship today. I give thanks for the worship and music committee as well, Elizabeth and Laureen preparing communion. The brighter Christmas tree is out here. We need you to take an ornament if there's any left out there on the Christmas trees and buy a gift for a child or an adult who is in need. We have all kinds of wonderful things going on. And my final charge to all of you is to just get involved. If you're not particularly involved, get involved in some form or fashion in the church, because God wants to bring your spiritual gifts to life for the blessing of one another and for the blessing of these communities. It's now time for us to turn to one of those psalms that I mentioned earlier. So I invite you to look into your bulletins or up onto the slides and join me as we continue giving thanks and praise to God. Get to the next slide, please, Nemat. There we go. I can't read it. I got to get a bulletin. Please join me in a responsive prayer of thanksgiving from Psalm 136. Let's give thanks to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods, the Lord of lords, whose steadfast love endures forever. God alone does great wonders, and who, by understanding, made the heavens. God alone, whose steadfast love endures forever. For God spread out the earth on the waters, made the great lights, the sun to rule over the day, the moon and the stars to rule over the night. God's steadfast love endures forever. It is God who remembered us in our low estate and rescued us from our foes. It is God who gives food to all flesh and who leads his people through the wilderness. Oh, give thanks to the God of heaven, for his steadfast love endures forever. I invite you now to give yourselves and your gifts back to God. I forgot to get the extra pledge cards into the pews, but there's all kinds of ways for you to make your pledge for 2024. Our Stewardship and Finance Committee would really appreciate it. And it's a good discipline for you all, because year by year, even if you meet that tithe level of giving 10% of your income to the Lord, even if you meet that level, guess what happens then? You keep giving a little more and a little more year by year, because we remember the poor widow who, out of her poverty, gave everything that she had. So let's remember the constant self-giving of our Lord and Savior Jesus, and seek to give of our time and our talents and our treasures, not just to the church, of course, but to the entire world around us, blessing the world and making the kingdom of heaven. Let's enjoy a wonderful solo.
Thank you. while we're standing, we're going to see and we're going to be reading from our Presbyterian Church USA brief statement of faith. Is this on a slide or in the bulletin? Whatever. All right, get your bulletins or slide, whatever is there. Okay. And together, in life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to eternal. Amen. You may be seated. Now, in your bulletins, the purple section, we're having another project. All right. We need gently worn or new winter outerwear, coats, hats, mittens, etc., for all ages for our friends at El Centro. And just to remind you, there are a lot of people from Central and South America, and El Centro Hispano Americano is one of our mission projects. Reverend Brooke Smith, who has preached here many times, he's on the board, I help out. So, go through your stuff. We all have stuff we even forget about. Now, and bring it. There's going to be a box there. There'll be boxes in the back. So, we'll start next Sunday, and through the first 3 weeks, and Andrew and I and Linda will be taking stuff that December 17th, 18th, something like that. You have any questions, talk to me or Linda. Thank you.
Please join me in prayer. The Lord be with you and also with you. Oh Lord God, we are so grateful. What a day to be celebrating and thanking you for being able to gather together in this place with our brothers and sisters here in the sanctuary and online. We thank you for music. We thank you for the gifts that you have given to some of us that are so wonderful, the ways that you're able to share. We thank you for our children, Lord, for their sharing of their love and your love for them. We thank you for the sunshine that we enjoy today. And Lord, we thank you for any kind of weather. We especially appreciate sunshine when we've had rain and clouds, but you give us good gifts. You give us great gifts in this land in which we live. The freedom that we have to gather together and worship. We are mindful that there are those brothers and sisters around the world who do not have the freedoms that we enjoy. And we lift up before you places around the world. We pray for peace, Lord. Oh, Lord, the land in which you walked is in strife, and we pray for peace there. We pray for peace in Ukraine. We pray for peace in Africa and in the southern continents and the northern places. There's lack of peace everywhere because we have not followed after you. And we're grateful that you pick us up and give us your love. And now we lift before you in silence or with our voices raised, things that we're thankful for, and people that we're concerned about who need your help.
The Hetzel family.
The Chapman family, all who are grieving.
The Chapman family, the Hetzel family, others who are grieving, Lord, losses that just tear apart families, and it takes time. We ask that you would comfort those who are mourning this day. We have Casey and Lindsay and Bruce. We pray for those who are ill, in need of healing, of body and mind and spirit. Lord, you know who they are. We pray for others who are approaching surgeries coming up soon. We pray for physicians. We thank you for them. We thank you for medical teams of taking care of our physical bodies, and for teams of people who help deal with our spiritual and emotional bodies. We pray for them, Lord. We thank you for teachers, and we thank you for those that teach us all the time. We thank you. Other thanksgivings or prayers, Lord? We thank you for our children, our youth. We pray that they would continue to challenge us to live differently. We pray for our leaders. We pray for peacemakers around the world. We pray for brothers and sisters. And we pray that you might continually change us, that we would be your witness in the world in which we live. Thank you for this time that we have together as a church family, to fellowship with one another. Lord, we pray too for those who may be alone this Thanksgiving day. Would you bless them? Let them see a smile perhaps on a face. Let them know that they are not alone, because you are always there. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would flood our nation with your presence and your power. And we pray together as you have taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now we will continue with the good gifts and continue to give thanks in song.
Verses 3-5.
Stand the lonely
charge you to make your life a glad offering to God, a song of thanksgiving. Go out into this world and share love and goodness and peace with all whom you meet. And join us for fellowship and food and the breaking of the bread over in the dining room. Receive a blessing. The grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. And God's people say, and by the way, I noticed when I was sitting there that the sound is funky, and I'm sorry about that. We'll get that fixed by next Sunday. Enjoy the rest of your weekend.